Well, good morning. Bom dia a todos. We are not so formal as we already see here. But anyway, we would like to welcome you. And we have here Professor Maria Isabel da Silva Leme, our Vice Director of this Institute, who will say some welcome words.
Bom dia a todos. Eu quero, em primeiro lugar, agradecer a presença de todos e especialmente ao professor Valsiner, cuja contribuição tenho certeza que vai ser muito boa para nós. E também agradecer muito a Lívia, ao Alessandro e ao Danilo pela organização desse evento, que é muito significativo para o Instituto de Psicologia. Obrigada.
Well, it's my turn. On behalf of the Laboratory of Verbal Interaction and Knowledge Construction of the Department of Experimental Psychology of this Institute, it's my joy and honor to welcome all of you for this public lecture of Professor Jaan Valsiner from the Aalborg University, Denmark. I warmly welcome our colleagues from abroad and their students that come to this house for a week dedicated to research formation and scientific production in the context of the international agreements between the University of São Paulo, Brazil, the Aalborg University, Denmark, and the University of Salerno, Italy. They are Professor Jaan Valsiner, Director of the Niels Bohr Professorship Center for Cultural Psychology of Aalborg University and collaborator of our laboratory from 1997. Professors Luca Tateo, Brady Wagoner, Vlad Glavenot, and Moens Jensen from the Aalborg University, Denmark. Professor Giuseppina Marsico from the University of Salerno, Italy. Professor Sven Roar Klempe from the Norwegian University of Science and Technology, Norway. And Professor Mike Vaclavic from the Sigmund Freud University of Berlin, Germany. And Professor Karen Pernil Wied from the University of Copenhagen, Denmark. At this moment, I would like to thank Professor Danilo Guimarães, my workmate at the laboratory and the department. Without his good spirit, competence, and dedication, this initiative would not be possible. Thank you. Now, Professor Alessandro will say some words.
Hello. Welcome to Brazil, welcome to São Paulo University. I am Alessandro, professor from Department of Social Psychology. I am responsible for the area of race, ethnicity, and intercultural studies. And I am the responsible for the trip to Temple of Odudua dos Orixás. It's an important temple in Brazil, and we combine there specific traditional ritual religions, and during the lunch, a kind of live show of samba, okay? If you have some problems here, or if you need something here, please call me. And my room is 121 and the second floor, and you can use my room however you think. Okay? Welcome.
Thank you, Alessandro. Danilo?
Well, I'm supposed to say something. And welcome to... I'm very glad that this workshop is now a reality. The idea started in 2014. as a suggestion from Professor Jaan Valsiner to strengthen the articulation between the New Lisbon Center of Cultural Psychology and the Laboratory of Verbal Interaction and Knowledge Construction that Livia and I are now coordinating. The original plan of this workshop was to focus on the ongoing research of the PhD and master students and the extension project some of us were developing together with the Amerindian peoples from São Paulo in the Amerindian Support Network. The idea was discussed with Livia when I came back to Brazil, and her contributions enriched the initial workshop proposal. We presented it to our Department of Experimental Psychology and the Institute of Psychology, and both of them rapidly offered all the institutional support to shelter this meeting, so you are very welcome. And also, our students, Master and PhD, realized the relevance of this meeting for their academic training and investigations. All of them were available to participate in the work group commission, and the postdoc researchers took part in the scientific commission. So thank you for these contributions. Finally, we got the important support from FAPESP, São Paulo Research Foundation, and from the Pro-Rectorship of Culture and Extension of the University of São Paulo, without which it would be impossible to organize the workshop. So I'm grateful to these funding agencies. Therefore, I would like to acknowledge all the people and institutions that have understood the relevance of this week to our research group and supported it. Thanks for that, we are being able to overcome distances, geographical, linguistic, cultural, and disciplinary. It's being constructed from a devoted work involving the articulation of psychology with philosophy, history, anthropology, arts, and other academic knowledge, and these areas with diverse traditional knowledge, either specialized or popular. So it's, I think it's, a big challenge, but also a good one. The open lecture from Professor Jaan Valsiner, listening to the screaming knowledge, pathways to quietude, is a good opportunity to share some of our academic expectancy to a broader public once the next activities are going to be restricted to our research group, in order to allow us to maximize the profit of this meeting to development of the ongoing research. So now we have a broader public. This lecture is being transmitted online through the internet. So thank you for the public that are listening to us in Brazil and abroad too. So thank you very much. Hope you enjoy the lecture, and to the research group, a good week of creative academic work. Thank you.
Now I give the session with Jaan Valsiner.
Now it should work, yeah? So, I'm very glad to be back here. to continue the job I started but did not complete 10 years ago, when I presented a little story about psychology as a factory, changing traditions in new epistemological challenges, back here in May 31st, 2005. Much to my disgrace, I didn't manage to write it up as a paper. So this time I am in a better position that I have finished the paper, which is available for you if you're interested. But I must warn you that what I'm going to say does not exactly coincide with what is in the paper, because I have become a little wiser after I finished the paper. Or sillier, you will decide yourself. What I'm going to talk about takes us to what could be called sociology of science, or maybe social psychology of science, maybe cultural anthropology of science. I don't know what label you may want to put at it. But absolutely knowing the enormous interest here in Sao Paulo in phenomena of disquiet, I decided to look at knowledge from a somewhat unusual perspective, namely, treat knowledge as screaming. Well, how can knowledge be screaming? Well, if nature can be screaming, as Edvard Munch very nicely has demonstrated more than 100 years ago, from an example of his own experience, which is a beautiful experience of my notion of hypergeneralization, then why can't knowledge scream? Well, why should it scream? Knowledge, as we know, is actually expected to be solid, objective, and useful, and not screaming at all. So why would I start to use the notion of screaming knowledge in application to something that should not be screaming at all, should be quiet, not disquieting anybody, should be shareable, should be publicly usable, should be very valuable, and so on? And I'm going to prove this morning that none of this is true. Knowledge is screaming in our societies in different directions, at different times, in different forms. It is not objective, even though we think it is. It is built on negotiation between different social entities, as well as persons applying, using the roles, and so on. So who are the different so-called stakeholders, which is a fashionable term to be used in modern administratively jargonized speech? Well, there are a number of them. You would have communicative messages from science to something called the society through the journalistic look. Something becomes a breakthrough. Danny Kahneman's 30 years of insistence that human minds do not work as computers or as statisticians would be suddenly becoming breakthrough when it came to the Nobel Prize. So you know, as a water moves against the stone, finally the stone breaks. So does the Nobel Committee. So, interlocutor of thinking among scientists themselves, scientific appropriation of knowledge. What the journalists call a breakthrough needs to be tested. You don't take the journalistic statement at the face value. You have to test it or even distrust it. This creates a disquietude which is not easy for scientists nor for journalists to handle. A possible source of profit may be there. You can want to patent a particular piece of knowledge. You see that in a number of ways in recent decades. You see very quick seeming breakthroughs announced in cold fusion to be immediately patented in the United States, only to be found out to be basic errors later on. But patented they stayed, so the errors are patented as well. It can be a source of personal, institutional, moral value. A scientist or non-scientist would consider some results simply to be beautiful, aesthetically pleasing. And nobody can take away that value. And this means knowledge is screaming with a beautiful, affective voice. It can be also denunciation of it as waste of resources. Many of us, when our grant applications are denied, were told that this would be a waste of taxpayers' money to spend it on these esoteric topics that we are proposing. And we are obviously not very pleased by that kind of a feedback. Or even it can be a danger to morality or its opposite. Sometimes political appropriation, this breakthrough will cardinally change our society for better or worse. So you see that the knowledge, whatever it may be, the specific target, is actually voiced over by different voices that are all speaking in different languages and oriented in different directions. Knowledge is not non-directional. Knowledge has always a direction when it is presented. So in these stakeholders, we come to, as I said, different goals, to which temporarily may seem to coincide, but only temporarily. For example, the opposition public must understand versus public cannot understand something is a very central opposition we constantly see in our public discourses about science and society. Science must have a practical value versus science is free from practical concerns is an opposition you see constantly socially negotiated in almost any society where science is supported and non-supported from time to time. So in addition to all of it, the very knowledge itself is developmentally ambiguous. It is not a fixed entity that we assume it is. Michael Polanyi had it very nicely said in 1962. New knowledge is not yet knowledge because it's new. It's not yet tested. It's a hypothesis that we are going to test. But at the same time, it is not old either. It's not the existing knowledge that we took for granted. It is something new. Science is constantly moving in this ambiguous zone of some understanding which is not any more long, old, but it is at the same time not proven as new and established. So in this sense, developmentally speaking, all knowledge is in constant ambiguous state. So independent of what textbook writers and journalists may want to tell us. So back in 2005, I introduced the focus on the notion of science as factory. I was worried then about the fact that most of our scientific productivity becomes factory production of more and more, and less relevant little things by more and more authors who pretend to be collective, which are not really that. In that context, and this slide and some others come from 10 years ago, actually, I was introducing Lorraine Daston's specific contrast between individual and manufactured type of objectivity. Lorraine Daston in 1992 introduced this contrast. In the history of sciences, you will see the first of life course study of something. It becomes objective because a person, the individual who has been studying it, is becoming more and more knowledgeable about that issue. Another person may be knowledgeable of the same issue. They may totally disagree, but the objectivity is in both because they are subjectively developing deep knowledge. That was the medieval, let us say, monastic model of objectivity, as Daston pointed out. By 19th century, you get to the manufacture model, where the depth of individual knowledge is no longer emphasized. Instead of that, agreement between knowledge makers becomes central. In psychology of today, you see that remnant of that in the empirical demand for inter-observer agreement in behavioral observations. There is no value in inter-observer agreement other than consensus. And every consensus can be equally adequate and equally wrong without extra knowledge, you wouldn't know that. I was adding a third version, which is especially invented in the last maybe 30 years, which I call corporationistic. This comes to me in the interesting repeated statements from different power-holding laboratories and research groups, which say that data from our esteemed lab shows that, and so on. The fact that the lab is esteemed doesn't show anything about the adequacy of the knowledge. It only says something about the social status of the lab. Statements about this kind are actually markers of the status and not markers of knowledge. So in other sense, if the statement is our data provide evidence for something, this can mean that actually there is a reference to the phenomenon under study. We would not deny that, but at the same time, it's a rhetoric support for this given corporation. That is, you see that in interesting ways in big conferences of keynote speakers, when they give you slide after slide after slide of data with an approximate exposure time of 25 seconds. And then when you ask a question about a particular number on the particular slide, they say, first of all, I don't know, which is a remarkable statement in itself in our self-presentational world, and very often they say it doesn't matter because it comes from our laboratory. Yeah? So I have heard that said, and it is quite remarkable in a public constituent domain. So that nothing can be further away from knowledge, nothing can be further, better example of alienation of knowledge in modern social organization of sciences. And it is exactly the question of corporationistic overtaking of our sciences that is important as a background of what I'm going to say here. So as I said, I was using the notion of factory in the 10 years ago, which basically allows us to look at science as a data factory, whether it is real, unwarranted, or is it desired. Coming back to psychology 10 years later, I would argue that psychology is an example of how corporationistic objectivity can lead to formal hyperproductivity together with a corresponding lack of theoretical creativity. In other sense, I'm positing very directly that the supposed success of psychology of publishing more and more papers in more and more peer-reviewed journals is basically an illusion of knowledge. It substitutes knowledge by specific accumulation, behind which is an absence of theoretical creativity. So how does it happen? Interestingly enough, behind that is 100 years or so of pragmatist philosophy translated into social demand systems in different societies. So if the value of science is that of a practical usefulness, and the particular usefulness is determined by a particular institution which stands in for society, then of course what we get is a specific, very interesting presentations of social representation of what the new developments in science mean. When Human Genome Project was in the making, you would hear the stories that it will absolutely lead us to the development of new drugs against something. It hasn't. In fact, it has created a new critical state in genetics where they cannot demonstrate the effects of genetic demonstrability, and you will see the genetics becoming epigenetics, which exactly would not develop any new drugs. In psychology, standardized tests, in basically linkable with social selection tasks, not social understanding tasks. And of course, some very popular topics like emotional intelligence, which are basically profits by the idea appeal. That is, when you have a label intelligence, you need to attach some nice little additional conditions to it. Emotional intelligence, sexual intelligence, absurd intelligence, and so on and so forth. All of these would be very highly appeal in journalistic world. So every country you would see in a watch in an airport bookstore, you will find a book on emotional intelligence being sold in particular language. I learned that in Brasilia many years ago, leaving Brasilia. Absolutely, that book must be there. The work by Brazilian psychologist was not. So this all leads us to the question of contrast between production and consumption of knowledge. This actually comes also from 10 years ago. But basically what we have here is the relevance of the producer-consumer relations, which changes together with societal change with other aspects of our lives. So the way of moving from using China to plastic cups is similar to the way of using psychology in particular version of journalistic presentations. So this leads us to the question of what is literature, or their literature to be more exact. Their literature is not only a pile of papers published and ever increasingly published, it acquires a certain magic value to it, which is interesting in itself. There is a literature on X or Y or Z. These publications, of course, that make up the literature are discrete objects, as you will see. But at what moment was this swarming of these publications or piling up of the publications on a particular topic becomes literature on X? And how would that particular surplus meaning to it would be developed? There are two problems here. One is contribution problem. And this actually resembles a so-called Sorites paradox. Would adding one more paper to a particular pile of literature be a new contribution? Would adding a review article based on N articles be a new contribution to the particular issue? Would the first paper published in a new area be the literature? Or does it take a second paper to become the literature? That's the Sorites paradox par excellence. The second part is a demarcation problem. Where are the borders, or are they at all, between literature on X and literature on Y? So it's a, where is the border between literature on attachment and literature on emotions, so to say. So this illustrates you with interesting aspects. What is called contribution to the literature cannot be a contribution to the literature. Because by assuming it's a contribution, it moves beyond the contribution. And knowledge of psychology screams for ideas. So here is a notion of screaming coming back to it. We may have very high piles of literature, but no knowledge. We may have only literature. My students are horrified when I tell them, if you start your project, do not read the literature. You will be confused. Rather, look at the phenomena, and only after you have carefully looked at the phenomena, only then you start reading selectively what is valuable out of the cold of the literature, and you ignore most of it. The only adaptation to the overflow of existing the literature is the development of strategies of ignoring rather than accepting. So in other sense, the proliferation of the literature necessarily leads to the development of new strategies, metacognitive strategies of dismissal. You can further speculate what that means for actual knowledge construction. We are constructing knowledge in order to dismiss it. We're almost like Buddhist monks with mandala. So furthermore, literature published very often is published, which we get published are opinions. But Gaston Bachelard already in 1938 pointed out that opinions are dead thoughts. They are finished thoughts. Nothing new can come from them. So if you have no doubt about in a particular way of thinking, if you are established in a particular opinion, whether it comes from your study or whether it comes from your prejudice, this is a dead thought. There is nowhere else to go. You can further think about how many psychology methods call for the opinion presentation rather than thought presentation in the methods itself. So, common sense demands full certainty. So it's not coincidental that opinions are prioritized. It's a common sense economy of thinking is something that will benefit, does benefit from this use of opinions and certainty. If X, then it is X. Yeah? If we know this is X, this is an X. Yeah? Well, science offers only possible certainty. If X is found, then possibly X exists. If X, water is found in that bottle, probably it exists in this bottle. We don't know. Well, the common sense uses a label, the water is in that bottle, but you can put any label on this bottle. So it would be interesting to look at it in a more realistic sense. I actually got that idea from discourse or discussion we had 4 years ago in Integrative Journal about a particular paper using an example of a vaccine effect. So there are social representations which are actually used in the case of looking at the arena of societal proliferation of knowledge, which I will define as an arena where our discourses on that take place. So all of this is done by different stakeholders or agents with different goal orientations. As I said, the goal orientations temporarily coincide, but not only temporarily so. So first of all, a certain vaccine, X, may be considered to lead to immunity from a particular disease, which is obviously socially valued good. But if it starts to give us side effects, then now what happens what? Well, first of all, this is Anna Mikulak's study using the measles, mumps, rubella vaccine in 1998. A paper was published in The Lancet, which indicated that the vaccine can actually lead to autistic side effects. So the question is, how can we say about vaccine being safe or non-safe? The interesting point that Rohr pointed out in his commentary is that the particular journal, leading journal, The Lancet, removes the published paper 12 years after it has been published, which is a remarkably long time. It was not removed because it was wrong. It was removed because it was controversial, which led the scientists involved in it to a rather unhappy situation where they said, well, we thought we could publish provocative results which lead to further studies. We now know that we cannot. We are silenced, and we remain in our disquietude, exactly as we are silenced by the social forces. This is a model that I will bring in to look at the process that is there. Some of you would know my interest in looking at opposites in meaning construction. This is one version of it, elaborated a little bit to illustrate the vaccine story. It's actually extremely simple. When something, let us see if we find the something. Here, no, we don't find the something. Is there something? No, anyway, you see the upper part. Oh, yes, now you see it. Something is considered to be safe. It can be safe in two ways, in a symbolic sense. It can be safe because it's said to be safe. Safe equals safe. This is safe because I say this is safe. No questions asked before that. Medical profession, the pharmaceutical profession says this drug is safe. Why is it safe? Because we, the company, says it is safe. Corporationistic objectivity par excellence. The other way, the scientific way, is this estimation that non-safe equals safe. In other sense, accepting the possibility that safe has to be tested for the opposite, the non-safe. And if you remember statistics in the first place, the statistical methods can only demonstrate difference. They cannot demonstrate sameness. They are blind to sameness. So the scientific study would demonstrate that no differences are found in the safety, and the non-safe finding is now interpreted as if it is safe. This is the second one. Both of them are actually built on two valent logics of different kinds. The two valent logics in history of science have been, of course, gold standard up to the end of the 19th century, early 20th century. Then the gold standard of two valent logic immediately eroded in the 20th century, including three-valued logic, including deontic logics, including very many other logics, all of which indicates that the issue of two valued opposites, say exclusive opposites of one not true as the other, is not true. From a point of view of a dynamic, systemic look at the relationship of meaning, you see that this cycle here blocks completely the doubt. Okay, this is a particular issue of doubt, that is what can happen in non-safe area is actually something is dangerous. You all know very well the overdose issue. Any drug that can cure, when taken in overdose, can kill. The question is how much overdose, under what circumstances, and so on. So in this sense, a drug cannot be safe in general. A drug is safe only under some conditions. Child care for children is good only under some conditions, but not others. Yeah. So you cannot ask the question generally, is child care good or bad, so to say. So you see that by reducing the discourses to this particular cycle and reducing them to either corporationistic declaration, this is safe, or empirical scientific declaration based on not finding non-safe conditions, it must be safe, we're actually losing all of this. This is exactly what the common sense wisdom actually does. It emphasizes that under certain circumstances, almost anything can become non-safe. So what this kind of scream means is that all of the discourses about knowledge are coming from, I would call it, we positions. These are we of illusory social units that act as if they are agents on societal power regulation. They are not institutions. They are presentations from institutions to the voices of persons who carry the same voices forward, so to say. So a person who says this is safe because this pharmaceutical company says so is representing a we position. We as experts say it is safe, but the we position becomes very closely linked with what Hermans has emphasized in I positions. I as a doctor, I as a consumer, or I as an ice cream seller tells you that the drug you are taking is safe. I as a doctor says the same. Yeah? So in this sense, the way position notion is an extension from the dialogical self theory in addition to specific vector of goal orientation. The way position has an orientation towards particular goal. It's not a representation of we, what we think as an illusory collective unit. We may mean I, we may mean you and me, we may mean the whole society we are representing, we may mean the whole world. But the specific we is never clear. So the screaming of knowledge is a result of negotiation of such we positions by passionate agents of their own I positions. Very often the people who are highly presenting the we positions have relevance for I positions. Or making science understandable to lay public in general is an impossible goal to reach. Instead, the negotiation of science and society works on what I call differentiated arenas. Not in general arenas, but differentiated arenas. This follows from the very standard, very classic model that Karl Bühler introduced by 1934. It was already there in the late 1920s, the so-called organon model of communication, which antedates the usually understood Shannon-Weaver model from late 1940s, which implies direct flow of information from one sender to the recipient. Here you see the negotiation of particular messages between the sender and recipient. The message is always ambiguous. The referent to which the message is oriented is the same, but the message itself is different because the sender and the receiver can never be in the same position. They can change the positions consequently, but they cannot be at the same position at the same time, so to say. So the result is basically that there is always ambiguity of the message represented by the triangle and by the circle in the middle. This classic speech psychology of Karl Bühler, a classic model of communication, which indicates that in principle, the complete understanding of the sender and the complete understanding by the receiver, that means complete sharing, quote, sharing of this middle message, is either in principle impossible, or if it happens, it's a coincidence of local circumstances. It may be temporary, it may be coerced at times, and so on and so forth. So on the basis of that, I would say that's a nice idea of sharing the scientific knowledge with the lay public is an unreachable goal. It's a maybe very noble goal, but very unreachable goal. Let me give you an example. The example comes from this little experiment here. In the year 2012, the particular nice little lander, Mars lander, called Curiosity, was on its way to landing on Mars. It did it successfully, and for the last 3 years, it has been transmitting signals, videos, and so on from Mars surface, which are interesting in themselves. It has managed to move on Mars surface over 10 kilometers in 3 years, which is a long distance given the engineering task given for the lander team. And they start sending it in interesting pictures. Now, some of the pictures may be doubted whether they are real, but here you see supposedly a Mars picture coming from Curiosity, which gives you the image of a spoon on Mars. Now, there are very interesting questions, a number of interesting questions coming out of it. First of all pictures that come back from far away distance, from any celestial object, Mars included, are in some sense fuzzy. They are about an object which we are just beginning to name, beginning to label, beginning to map in a usual mapping sense. And suddenly we make an everyday life analogy with a spoon. What comes after that? Well, maybe next one to find is a soup bowl next to it, and we find the first Martian restaurant, the first McDonald's on Mars, so maybe, of course I have Vlad in mind here, sushi bar in Mars. Very unlikely, of course, but you can see something in that half-choking notion which is not choking at all. what is carried on to Mars is a projection of something from Earth, something very ordinary from our everyday life. And spoon is an ordinary object from everyday life. So that leads me to the question, serious question from knowledge, for whose consumption am I is a screen? Well, the Mars landing story is interesting because here you can demonstrate very nicely the borders of mutual sharedness of the question, research question, together with mutual non-sharedness of exactly the same question. And the interesting issue is, of course, the question of water on Mars. This has been always assumed about, talked about, is there water on Mars? Before Mars landing, we didn't know. Now with Mars landings, we know more and more and more, okay? We know that there is water even on comets. But the question is, why is this question important? For whom is this important? For whom is that knowledge important? Well, for an ordinary person planning to have a retirement home on Mars, which is being talked about, of course, the question is very crucial. Can you make a cup of tea when you have landed in Mars, and can you actually drink the tea under the Martian condition? For scientists, this is an irrelevant question, obviously. Water in Mars is not water in the sense of what we drink or what we use. The water in Mars is only a little bit of a basic biochemical processes that could be assumed coming from the external observation of the border of the Mars surface. Because what is at stake in all of these Mars landers is touching the surface, touching the border of Mars, trying to penetrate into that border, the topic we'll be discussing a little later today, with a goal of understanding what is inside of that planet, not what can be cooked in a fish restaurant in Mars with a spoon. Yeah? So this is really what this is a question about. And this is, but at the same time, the nice photos that are given to public in great quantity. The Martian program is very clever in producing publicly valuable photos available on the internet, is actually promoting something very interesting. By finding that water is there, we are coming to the glorification of the given science, which is actually very simple. We used to think X as we knew Y, but now we have learned that it's Z. That is, it demonstrates a progress in science, that is on material that is understandable in everyday life terms, like water. If it's a question about a hyper-complex chemical reaction, then it will not be understandable in everyday life terms. So, and of course, there is a storytelling that we thought that Mars was simple, but it's not simple, so we can say the same about the human mind in some sense. This is even more interesting public use of Martian pictures. This is actually the selected picture based on a Hollywood movie, The Martian, corresponding to it a particular novel. The author of the novel gave the Martian scientists idea where the specific place should be on Mars. So they would locate and photograph that place and actually modify it, because the color here is obviously added, it's not there. In the original photo, the original photos are like this. This I take out of what they claim is the original picture of this area, or this, two examples of them. So you see that what happens is that first of all, there is a Hollywood movie that leads to the selection of particular observation. Then the image of that particular observation is produced. So this is authentic image located exactly on the place where the Hollywood movie said the Martian events happened. And then through the association with the movie, the analogical reasoning is pushed. Basically, the imagery of tourist trip to Mars. Let us go and see the places where the actions of the movie took place. The actions of the movie didn't take place on Mars. But the linking of this particular Mars photograph with a Hollywood movie creates a beautiful illusion of a potential imaginary tourist trip, which is a beautiful example for Daniel Zeitoun's notion of symbolic resource for laypersons. That is, it has no scientific value, but it has enormous value as a particular material for curious people looking at curiosities pictures of the Mars. The result is interesting. The public gets to play imaginatively. Movie rentals may get few more interest in old movies. And scientists get the symbolic fortification that they do important research. Remember that in the case of planetary science, it is extremely difficult to prove to the granting agencies that what they are doing has concrete practical applicability. Now, in psychology, we ask all the time, what is the value of the little study you do? And we are usually mute because we don't know what they're actually going to do. But in other sciences, this question is asked as well. About 1 hour after I finished the paper version for today, I was listening to the first interview with Albert MacDonald, the person who got the Nobel Prize for neutrino, one of the three. And after a few questions about how it feels, this one very nice Swedish woman journalist asked with beautiful Swedish accent, but what will be the practical use of having demonstrated that neutrino has a mass? And the poor Nobel Prize winner had to go back and forth in thus discussing what on earth would this mean. He has spent most of his time under the ground in the neutrino laboratory, because that's the only way you can find the neutrinos. They otherwise interfered with all other things. And now he has to demonstrate that this neutrino would somehow change our social life to the better, which is so to say. So it's a good example of how the question is asked even when it is basically unaskable. So what I say is that all public understanding of science is based on the history of social representation in the given society. And this consists of three layers. When we're talking about ordinary things, then there is very little knowledge that we would want to discover because we accept it as ordinary. There is an extraordinary aspect of all of this. And the last one is a monstrous aspect. So we have basically all of our knowledge is dividable into three zones: ordinary, extraordinary, which can be miraculous, and monstrous, which can be dangerous. And you can see the relation to that knowledge. We are screaming about the knowledge, not the knowledge screaming for us. So whom would you find if your chances are to be enhanced, see her enhanced? For example, we are talking not about Mars landing, where the chances are enhanced by the technology. We are talking about 17th century notion of finding the microscope, looking exactly into the microscopic world. Antoni van Leeuwenhoek, one of the aspects of his 1670s discoveries of various things, led to the question of all these microorganisms may be actually demonstrations of the devil. This fitted perfectly the social representation network of the 17th century. Of course, for us, this is slightly esoteric, but nevertheless, if we replace the devil by the potential side effects of a particular drug, then it's not so mythologically different. So I'm trying to use my very old scheme of about 15 years of age, which is meant to be semiotic demand setting, about public discourses in general, to illustrate the question of how public understanding of science and how scientific understanding of science partially coincide, and where they coincide and where they differentiate. The original scheme was about basic question of social discourses, emphasizing that there is a certain, in our societal world, with a certain zone of our promoted talking, where we are expected to talk about something very actively. We are expected to talk about politics all the time, or the calamity of life or whatever. But next to this, and this was the important point of the scheme, is a taboo zone of talking. We're not supposed to talk about something else. If we try to talk, we feel uncomfortable, and we are stopped from talking because it's socially unacceptable and so on, so to say. And in addition to that, there is a zone of possible talking, but not yet promoted. So it's a very simple carryover of my old ideas into the different zones and into here. The focus at that time was that different people would be forced to express opinions on different opposing sides. The important point is opinions don't matter because they are just game, nothing more. Now I'm superimposing here what is the differentiated arena for what public understanding is expected to be. This would include all of it. That is, from the point of view of Martian scientists and probably somebody else in other sciences the same way, This includes both the promoted talking, possible talking, and of course the different opinions. So after the Mars landing photos, you may have people in cafes, pubs, and so on, endlessly discussing whether it is really true that there is water on Mars, whether there were lakes on Mars, and so on. It's a very nice public discussion topic of absolutely no relevance for science. But it is important for public image of the given science, no doubt. Yeah. At the same time, there is the discourse of the scientists themselves, which includes the taboo of talking area, because they have to be included. You never know where actually new knowledge emerges out of the taboo areas. It also includes the promoted talking area, possible talking area, but it excludes the expression of opinions. So whenever you see Nobel laureates expressing their opinions outside of their topical area, that is what they are doing for public. They are using their particular scientific credentials to enter into this kind of discourses. So, whereas at the same time, all of what they did in science is done actually in this area. There is a certain overlap, you see. So it's not the case that the two registers of discourse are totally separate. The same way as the water we're talking about can be here in the bottle and can be on Mars in, as a historic remnant of a particular story. So what does it lead us in terms of our psychological issues? It leads us to a somewhat paradoxical conclusion, which I hope is not counterproductive, but hopefully productive. Psychologists and other social scientists have the lesson to learn from all of that. Being useful to society in direct ways, and I emphasize indirect ways here, may be actually a useless effort, both for the science and paradoxically also to the society. So I hope it has been of somewhat important scream, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Jaan, for this very interesting lecture. I think it's a very important. There are very important recommendations to us to think and always criticize the knowledge we have already constructed. Well, we have some room to questions if you want to have some time to questions. All the questions need to be made with the microphone in order to people to listen, and the lecture is being registered, so we need you to talk in the microphone. I have a question, if I can start. You say that the knowledge is always constructed under the basis of common sense or some myths of a society. And now I'm really concerned, as I'm working with Amerindian people, and they have different common sense and different myths, my question is, how do they can construct science based on different myths than the myths of the Western societies? Because our science, for instance, psychology, is based on some presuppositions from the Westerns. But is it possible, in your opinion, to make science based on different presuppositions or different common sense from different cultures? Or we always need to link it with the common sense of the Western society?
Well, you can consider Western society also as an indigenous society. It is not different from Amerindian societies in this sense. It has its own historical development, which parallels very often something that you see in Amerindian societies these days, only it may have happened some centuries ago and along similar lines. Now maybe we can start from this contrast between dead thoughts being opinions and thoughts that are not dead. Both in our Western society and in Amerindian society, or any so-called indigenous society, there will be numerous presentations of their particular social values that are given through opinions, that are opposed to the opinions of the West, for example. This comes back to the scheme in the very end, this one. Basically, when we talk about the contrast of opinions between one society and another, let us say Amerindian society, we are talking about clashes of opinions. My point is that the clashes of opinions do not produce anything new. This is actually not my point, but Bachelard's point, or my point built on Bachelard's point. Something new is produced somewhere else. It's produced somewhere at the border of this topic of possible talking and taboo of talking. In every society, be this Western or Amerindian or any other indigenous society, you will have that border. Where it is located is not the same in different societies. It's a border is somewhere else. Research investigation for innovation in any of these societies are actually looking at this border. Innovation in a so-called Western society, be it Brazilian or North American or Danish or German or whatever, is somewhat discourse exactly here. Not here, the promoted one, but exactly the possible, but not yet promoted, and the taboo talking that is there. You would see the taboo areas of talk in very many cases. You were just discussing it the other day, how different aspects of immigrants in European societies are actually becoming taboo areas of talk. Some other areas are talked over, the television is filled with talk about immigrants, but something here is totally tabooed. In other sense, real development of any society happens somewhere here. What does it mean for Amerindian study? It means that you are not probably finding this in Amerindian community. You will find it in the periphery. And the periphery is not the community, but the periphery is immigrants out of the community to, let us say, Sao Paulo. The Amerindian people who are living in Sao Paulo, coping with Sao Paulo, but at the same time coping with Amerindian heritage. This is where the specific innovation of that society comes in, because the society is not closed. The society is open. Immigrants in present day are proudly owners of their cellular phones and iPhones. They use them in constant ways. So they are not just refugees who are hopeless and helpless. They are well-prepared refugees in many ways. The same way all technology leads to innovation on this border somewhere. So that's my simple question. But you notice I'm making no difference between indigenous and so-called industrialized societies. They are all indigenous in their own historical ways.
Thank you. Yeah. We have Luca and Livia. And before you ask, I just want to say that there is a book. If you need a certificate, you can sign, put your name in this sheet we are going to pass by you. Then you can get an online certificate. Okay.
Just a very short question about the interesting concept of ordinary, extraordinary, and monstrous of Dustin. I was wondering whether this is you use it as a typology, or rather is more a dynamic thing. For instance, things that can turn from ordinary to monstrous, or be at the same time ordinary, extraordinary, and monstrous. And whether, for instance, what is the role of sublime? If you can place sublime in that case, I was thinking, for instance, to physicians like Einstein, like Einstein, that were guided by this idea of sublime in their theories.
Yeah, I use Dustin and Bach distinction of the three, which say they assumed as a categories. I would say that this is a dynamic movement from one category to another to a third. That's why there's something that is extraordinary may become ordinary very easily, and you have in your pockets extraordinary thing that is very ordinary, called the cell phone, so to say. there are also extraordinary things that can become not only extraordinary but monstrous. Somebody who is suddenly diagnosed by some particular disease which is non-curable and potentially harmful becomes essentially a monster who is to be quarantined and taken away and so on. So, or some aspects of technological advances may become immediately monstrous when you start thinking about, for example, genetically changed crops and so on. They're still crops. A tomato genetically changed is still a crop, but you know that it's a monster now sitting there, right? Nice red monster in front of us. So in this sense, all of the three categories have dynamic transitions, which in themselves are important to study. Now, the notion of sublime here is very directly on the border of these categories. You would see the particular, if you go back to the notion of sublime in the original notion, it's an effect which is ambivalent in itself. You know? It's an appealing effect which is at the same time dangerous. Every border transition from the ordinary to extraordinary, and especially from extraordinary to the monstrous, becomes exactly organized by that sublimity. Since the sublimity is an underdeveloped concept in at least psychology, then of course we know very little about it. We have not paid any attention to these border crossings.
I'd like to know if you could tell us something about the role or the place of art in this scheme, or in this idea, better saying, in this idea. Visual arts or literature or whatever. If you could.
No?
Nothing about the taboo of talking about art? Because I was thinking about the place of the art production, the role of art in this screaming, especially because, you began with Munch, the screaming of knowledge, but,
My difficulty in answering your question is in the fact that art is very poorly definable as a concept. Without any doubt, it has similarity to science in the process of discovery. The difference being only that science is a more strictly constrained art, form of art, whereas art is less strictly constrained, if I may put it this way. In this sense, the answer to your question is yes, of course, the role is there. If you ask the question, what is the role exactly, for example, in this particular story, then I can say I don't know. Because first we have to specify what kind of art, under what circumstances. You would start to emphasize in what forms art forms start to feed into science. You could actually go back to my example of the Martian landing and taking a Hollywood movie and turning it into a tool for scientists to show the Mars, for example. Would that give us anything new? I don't know.
Someone else?
If under any conditions the public understanding and imagination of scientific discoveries might feed into further innovation in science. I heard some discussions of, for example, actually life starting on Mars, and through some comet or something it was reflected to Earth, and actually all life started from this point. And if something like this is a public discussion, it's not scientists, might feed some kind of further scientific discovery and innovation. Does that make sense?
Well, imagination, as we know, has all kinds of possibilities, including projecting the particular possibilities outside of our ordinary world, including extraordinary, including monstrous. Now, this can happen very nicely also in the projections into extraterrestrial worlds, so to say. So, from there, it is always possible to borrow something for the development of science. Let us not forget the Kekulé stream of discovering or inventing the notion of the benzene ring, which was said to come by himself to him in a dream. Of course, before his dream, the same image of a snake eating what's on its own, snacking on its own snake or tail, is actually there in the alchemic thinking for the previous 300 plus years. Kekulé was not exactly reflecting that in his dream. He would, but the connection historically would be there. So in this respect, there is a specific historically established social representation operating through the imaginary world of a dreamer, turning into a specific scientific invention. So that's a demonstrable sequence. Yeah.
Just a very short comment. I was thinking about science fiction as one linking also to Livia. Point. So science fiction could be an example of some form of artistic creation which is exactly originating from the taboo zone, so something which is not talkable because not even imagined before, but feeds into some kind of scientific discovery later on, since you can think from the Jules Verne novels, for instance, onward. So the first idea of the submarine, or the moon, the travel on the moon. So it's something which is completely unimagined or not talked about so far, but from that moment on feeds into or makes talkable this kind of possibility.
What you are suggesting is actually a very concrete research program that could be very nicely put to practice, because science fiction is an existing set of core texts that can be analyzed. The story of how some aspects of this text may have entered into one or another science and led to one or another actual innovation is probably post factum doable. It would be something for historians of science, sociologists of science, anthropologists of science to do. It would have very interesting psychological implications as well, because if you can demonstrate the move from a science fiction specific feature to an innovation of an idea that is, so to say, indeed a breakthrough along the lines of what you would see, breaking with a classical logic, breaking with a question of reversibility of time in physics and so on, or even the recent talk of the last 30 years of finding the neutrino mass and so on. These are transitions that are qualitatively dramatic. But whether they are or are not linked with a science fiction before is not established.
I agree with Luca, but I was also thinking about the canvas, the picture of Munch, and its role in your construction. No, the other. No, okay.
It comes back, I hope.
Okay.
No, it doesn't come back. Yes, yeah. It does come back.
This picture, the function, so to speak, or the role, or the place, I prefer, of this situation of Munch and the screaming in your, Valsiner's, production of this talk. So I think that at least on this way we can see a relationship and in that scheme, your proposal, maybe Munch was talking, was promoting some talking with you. Well, it's
no, I must, the analogy is there, but it is not developmental. I actually came to Munch only after I had completed most of the ideas in this
but
talk.
But you came paper. To him. So anyway,
it seemed was for me very good analogy, and it actually works for me for another sense, as I said, the hypergeneralization sense.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought it was a nice starting point to the screaming notion.
Yeah.
The origin of the screaming notion is actually new rather than Munch, because of the focus on disquietude in the whole research project here in Sao Paulo.
Okay.
This is actually the starting point of my deciding that knowledge might be screaming too.
Okay. But we can talk later, but anyway, I'm not trying to fix some cause-effect, this is inspiring me about that anyway, even a posteriori, you went to Munch, so something is disquieting here in my mind. So anyway,
I'm very happy
thank you.
About that disquiet.
I don't want to get too much into it, but what Luca and what you just said about science fiction, like it is actually happening already with like Star Trek, but the dialogue goes both ways. The people who create Star Trek have like discussions with scientists what they imagine will be possible in the future, and then they kind of depict what in the minds of the director of those movies what they think the physicians said what could look like. So there's this ongoing interaction and transformation probably of influences that cannot be tracked only in one way, but that is already happening, and is like, and they were pretty close, like with the cell phones and touch screens, those were like discussions that they had with scientists where it wasn't possible yet. And then in movies they showed how it could look like, and the actual what it looked like later was pretty close to what they had imagined it to be. What the influence then are and which way they went, and it was probably in many different directions. So it's hard to track in the end, like who influenced who and was imagining what on, by what trigger. So it's kind of a multi-complex thing again, like that's hard to find.
So my only question is, when will you do the study and when will you publish it as a study number one in the literature?
Okay, so we have an article to write, but I don't think in terms of influence actually. I think rather in terms of moving from the taboo zone to the zone in which something is speakable, or is exactly that, because probably even the scientists that were working in some, even the Jules Verne or the 19th century writers, they were amateur scientists, so they were perfectly aware of the most recent, you know, advancement. So probably it's exactly that, moving from something which is everybody is in the air, but nobody can speak about that publicly, to the zone of talking, of possible talking.
Thank you for both presentation and this discussion. I just wanted to have a comment on the scream of Munch. If you go back to the to the painting again, because I actually grew up in the neighborhood of this place, and what you see in the background is actually Oslo and the Oslo Fjord, and you see the boat in the middle there. And this is a very, very nice touristic view in Oslo. He painted it in Berlin, but he took the motif from Oslo. But the interesting thing is that Munch had a great dispute with a small group that represents the realism in painting in Norway. And he accused them for not being realistic, although they were focusing very much on details. And the question now is, to what extent was Munch realistic? I don't think anyone of you can recognize Oslo in this picture. And but it is there. And this, I think, makes that probably the painting is demonstrating much more of the points in your lecture, in the sense that there are very close connections between the way of thinking about realism in both science and art.
Thanks. This is a very important elaboration of Munch in this case. Almost certainly what you said fits very well. Let me only add that what Munch is realistic about is realistic about the scream. He's not realistic about Oslo. In other sense, there are multiple realistic, what is realism need not be what is depicted. And this same can be said about highly realistic art, let us say 16th century landscape paintings that emerged in Central Europe, which look realistic, but they are not realistic at all, in the sense that they are basically defying the accepted, in this time, Catholic religious backgrounds, where they eliminated from the landscape the religious figures that should have been there but were not.
Sorry, and could you show once again the last schema?
Uh-huh.
Okay, because I was wondering, all our comments is about how we...
No.
This one.
No. Oh, God. Here we go. Okay.
That one.
This one, yeah.
Okay. So, as far as I understood, it's quite possible under certain circumstances that something moved from taboo zone to zone of possible talking, and then from zone of possible talking, thanks to the permeability of that circle, let me say so, moving into the opinion zone.
Oh, yeah.
But my question is, if the movement is only in that direction, the taboo zone will be empty at certain point, you know? Mm-hmm. So something became talkable.
Yeah.
And then even commodities when entering into the opinion area. So yeah. How it's possible, how that area of taboo keeps staying alive, let me say so, in which way is feeding from something.
Yeah.
So, which is the movement in which something became a taboo? There is a movement.
Yeah, this is very concretely addressable topic. At what moment something innovative, in particular societal domain, after being talked about publicly and very much exchange of opinion, would disappear and become taboo topic. With Nacho, we were discussing the other day the silence about civil war in Spain and the different collaborations. So something that could be talked about in one domain would not actually be talkable in other ones. The silences that grow out of socially complicated topics would go into the taboo zone. I have not worked on this, but this is a very interesting elaboration, which is missing here indeed, and very realistic, because certain aspects of non-talkability, even in family context, would be quite directly linked with this. The work of Maria Elisa Molina in Chile on the family impact of child abuse gives us many examples of this non-talkability becoming taboo in the family context. That is, an event happens which becomes actually not through the talkability notion, but actually without it, moves directly into here. But even more interesting would be the going through a very active public discourse and then disappearing. Yeah. But I don't see any that leading into specific transitions in science. It's, although it's anything may be possible.
Well, we have room for maybe a couple of questions, if someone are interested to.
With the last slide, like after this one, you said that it's there's no direct way, really, between like the science and the usefulness for society, but there, like the communication, like takes place anyhow. Like also, especially with the journalistic appropriation that you mentioned in the beginning. Yeah. So, what would the recommendations for scientists be?
Like, well, what? The example from the Mars or the astrophysics is actually a pretty good example of what scientists do actually to successfully reach their own public goals by providing a playground for the public domain, which is interesting, appealing, and at the same time repeating itself. The story about is there water on Mars will go on already many decades, so to say, and at the same time securing one's own special area where the journalists have no competence actually in entering into what the scientists are doing. Therefore, guaranteeing that the possibility to move exactly here is possible. For imagine that there is a very nice journalist who is actually very close to the scientific enterprise here and detects that the scientists are about to enter the zone of taboo talking with, for some particular specific and relevant phenomenon. This coming out instantly into the public domain would basically undermine the possibility of developing this idea further, so to say. So in other sense, protection from publicity is equally important as the presentation of publicity. They go hand in hand. So that the question is selective protection, selective exposure of what scientists are doing. And that is what you see in physical sciences. That is what you don't see in psychology very easily. Psychology has been very naively assuming that they have to be servants for society. Mm-hmm. But society is not a homogeneous entity. It is not an entity that has benevolent goals vis-à-vis individuals. It has very many different goals by very many different carriers of the we positions, the result of which is that psychologists would always be somewhere in between of the different we positions. And sometimes successfully, sometimes not, but that's basically the simple solution. There's already solution right there in this.
So being selective and like providing a playground, but also protecting parts of it.
Precisely. You create the playground, and then you also protect something else from being a playground.
Okay, so here's a new example. Then what? You know, in much social research, at present, people are working with different forms or variation of deliberation processes, where they're precisely collecting people from who has different positions in regard to a specific problem. Mm-hmm. And because the problem is so complex, mm-hmm. no scientist can solve it alone because mm-hmm. they cannot foresee how it will turn up in a new complex variation for all these interdependent people who are connected with the problem. Mm-hmm. So here it's sort of a, isn't that a situation where a bit of turnaround in the sense that you need all these public interpretation in order to forward your social research? Oh, what would you think about that kind of scenario?
Well, yes, of course you need these public interpretations, the knowledge of them. But this knowledge of them need not be automatically the basis for the actual elaborations. Maybe some of it can be, not everything. That's my only point. That's it. Of course the knowledge is important. That is, you need to know the existing social representations about a particular phenomena in order to know how you present this as a for example, as a result of your particular findings in your research. Very often you see people who would be presenting these findings, what is picked up from the findings is exactly different from what they think the findings are. That's and this comes from the very clear social representation notion. So let us say, imagine that you discover that smoking can be good for human health in the present day environment. How will you bring that to the way public at the present day? What would be the vehicle to turn around the anti-smoking campaign that is probably going on in the last 20 years to the extreme? That it will be turned around sooner or later is for sure, because it has been going back and forth over centuries. But the question is how? What do you need to add or bring into the existing social representations to make that shift back? That's a less dramatic examples are the ones where you see withdrawal or taking away of seemingly productive drugs because of the side effects. What does it take to decide to take away a drug which has been hailed for the previous times so very important for solving a given problem? Suddenly it's boom, out.
Well, thank you very much, Jaan, for the lecture, and thank you all for the questions, very interesting questions. Now we have a cultural presentation, Cantoria Amazônica, African Songs and Amerindian Legends, with Eloisa Leão, that's a master student from our research group, José Maria Cardoso and Marcos Aragoni. We have here a folder with the songs, if you want to take one. Do you want one? Do you have? Yeah, thank you. So please come. It was carefully and kindly offered by Eloisa to us.